sound, you know what time it is. It's time for the Backstretch, brought to you by the Palm Beach Kennel Club, Belvedere Congress, West Palm Beach. It's where we are every Friday night. I'm Mike Balsamo. This is the True Oldies Channel. With me, as always, Benny the Boot, also Mike Jamieson, your track announcer, and Palm Beach Jason of Watch and Wager. You can hear this show every single week at TrueOldiesFLA.com, and it's available on the Palm Beach Kennel Club's Facebook page just about an hour after we wrap up. Poker Room Bad Beat Jackpot flying, $176,000. Double high hands on the weekends. High hands every hour. You got to be in it to win it. The Palm Beach Kennel Club's Poker Room is the place to be. You know, Mike, speaking about the Poker Room, looking around, it's a sea of red shirts, and that's always a good thing when the Palm Beach Kennel Club is wearing some t-shirts. Tell us about it.
Yeah, this is the month every year, August, that we support local greyhound adoption groups with Greyhound Adoption Month. And that's where we raise money for our local groups. And, I mean, we can't do it alone. We work with so many fantastic adoption groups that find homes for all these greyhounds that retire. And this is the month that we give back. And we try to raise as much money for them. We're going to actually have our track walk for Greyhound adoption. It's going to come up. This year we're going to do it a little differently. We're going to do it on Labor Day, which is September 3rd. So that's going to make that day even bigger with the Labor Day Puppy Stakes, which we'll touch on a little bit later. But September 3rd is the day of the track walk for Greyhound adoption. And to help out, you can come and make donations anytime at the info stands. Or on that day, September 3rd, you come out, bring everybody you know, and all your family and friends. For $25, you'll get a t-shirt just like the employees are wearing, and you get to walk in the track walk for Greyhound adoption.
You know, Palm Beach Jason of Watch and Wagers here. Jason, we're going to talk more about greyhounds in just a little bit, but it's an amazing, it's like a 99.9% adoption rate that the Palm Beach Kennel Club's adoption services succeed with.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's really industry-wide, too. If you look around, every track has their own adoption program. Palm Beach does a fabulous job, just like Mike was saying, but all the other tracks are doing the same thing, and that's why the adoption rate is as high as it is. It's the highest rate for any breed of any animal in the history of anything. So, I mean, the greyhounds are doing something right, and the people that are helping them are doing something right. Just keep doing what they're doing because the greyhounds are happy, and so are the people that have them.
And, Mike, you know, you've owned greyhounds before, and a lot of people might think, oh, greyhound, I'm going to need, you know, a 200-yard, you know, strip in my backyard for it to run on. It's really not the case with these retired pups.
I mean, you do need a track. I mean, if you don't have a they don't need any room at all. I mean, you know, greyhounds are actually really good apartment dogs. And, you know, when I've had greyhounds in the past, my first greyhound I got when I was like 12 years old. And I went in the backyard, cleaned up the backyard. We had an overground pool that I made a little track around. I think all the work that I put in, the dog ran around the pool one time in all the time that I had it. But, you know, they make such fantastic pets, whether it's for young families, whether it's for senior citizens or whoever. I love greyhounds. You know, I think they make the most fantastic pets of any other animal. They come to you already crate trained, already potty trained. They've gone through that puppy phase. You can get them very young, too. You can get them greyhounds that, you know, are sometimes a year old that, you know, just didn't make the track. I mean, if you are in touch with people that, you know, work on the greyhound farms, I know people that get greyhound puppies. I mean, you know, they like the misconception about greyhounds is that if they can't race, then bad things happen, and that's not true. I mean, all the greyhounds are accounted for, and you know, they do make fantastic pets. Anybody who gets a greyhound, the next thing you do automatically is you get a second one because it's awesome.
Oh, it's the Backstretch brought to you by the Palm Beach Kennel Club, Belvedere Congress, West Palm Beach. This is 95.9, the True Oldies Channel. Mike Balsamo, Benny the Boot, Palm Beach Jason of Watch and Wager, Mike Jamieson, your track announcer. You know, Jason, speaking of, you know, taking care of our athlete greyhounds, Arthur Gannis put out a press release on Twitter, I believe. I'm not big on Twitter, but I know that you're all over it. What's Arthur's plan here?
Well, what was going on in the Palm Beach area was there is a Palm Beach Animal Control Center there. And I guess you guys are having some extreme heat down there. Well, it's Florida in August. You would expect that. And in the actual facilities, they're not having good ventilation. Like, the air conditioning is not working well. And the heat there is getting up to, like, 90, 100 degrees with these animals. And so the Kennel Association with Arthur Gannis and some other people at Palm Beach said, this is not right. We got to take care of this. And actually what happened is Palm Beach and all the people that work with them actually are loaning them air conditioners to get these dogs and get the animals back to a normal temperature. Because you know, if you've been in the kennels at Palm Beach, those things are regulated with air all year long. I mean, it's a perfect 70-some degrees no matter what's going on. But these animal control centers are not like that. And so the Palm Beach dog people are helping out and making sure that the people around there are taken care of, not just greyhounds, but the dogs in general, people helping people.
And that's what we do at the Palm Beach Kennel Club and all throughout the greyhound industry is just try to take care of greyhounds and all animals in general. And we'll talk more about that in just a second. One of the things that we need is for people to we need 13 to be off the ballot, Jason. Where do we stand right now?
Well, what happened this week is that Pam Bondi, who's the attorney general, and the people that are supporting the ban, Amendment 13, to ban greyhound racing by the end of 2020, got the suit sent up to the Florida Supreme Court. And actually, that court date is now set for Wednesday, August 29th, for oral arguments where both sides will say their stories. And then the Supreme Court actually will rule on that. Now, it's been expedited, so we're expecting this decision to be done by the end of September. So we should know either way in the next month or month and a half whether this ban or this amendment is going to go to the voters. They have to overturn the original ruling, which happened in circuit court, for this to happen. But at this point, it's in the Supreme Court. We just have to see what happens.
Jason, you know, kind of tying into this, I know J.S. Speedy Pebbles, obviously your favorite greyhound ever, but there is a new darling at the Palm Beach Kennel Club. It's Macy, a.k.a. Eyes Appealin' from Lester Raines Kennel, and we're going to get to see a little bit more of Macy in the upcoming weeks.
Yeah, and there's going to be millions of people that are going to be able to see Eyes Appealin'. That's because there is now a digital billboard that's flying on 95 with Eyes Appealin' and trainer Kurt Trajcek hugging on there, talking about voting no on Amendment 13. And basically, it was started by a committee called Committee to Support Greyhounds, and who's basically just kennel people and people around the country that love the dog that got together and were fighting against Amendment 13. But they're putting these digital billboards up. And so if you're driving on 95 heading towards the kennel club in the next couple months, you're going to be able to see Macy and Kurt Trajcek having a hug. And this billboard is actually going to be in Fort Myers and Jacksonville, too. So any of these busy highways, you're going to be able to see greyhounds. From here on out, this is something that's going to continue even after this amendment goes down. You're going to see greyhounds on your way to work.
I love seeing greyhounds on my way to work. That's why I enjoy working here at the Palm Beach Kennel Club. Mike, Labor Day Puppy Stakes kicks off next week. You know, we always go into this, at least the last couple, and there's been some real up-and-coming superstars, and this field may not have that one or two or litter that really stands out.
Yeah, I mean, Benny the Boot's been talking about it for a while. He talked to Norm Rader, obviously from the Radar Racing team, a few weeks ago. And there's not the strongest crop of puppies, okay, let's be honest. I mean, all these puppy races, we try to make superstars out of some of these, you know raised meat greyhounds. But always in these puppy races, we start seeing the growth of certain dogs and animals that go from just a no-name, you know, young greyhound, a well-known name we talk about on this show, and possibly a superstar. And if you look back at all these puppy races that we do, three of them a year for the youngsters, and to be eligible for that race, they have to meet age requirements. I'm not totally sure of the age requirements as of right now, but they have to be a certain age or younger. And they have to have broken their maiden at the Palm Beach Kennel Club to be able to be eligible in these races. So greyhounds can't come in from other tracks and come in and kind of steal this stakes race. You actually have to have started out at Palm Beach. But as in every single puppy race, in 2-3 weeks from now, we're going to be talking about certain greyhounds that are going to be ones to watch for a long time.
You know, Palm Beach, Jason, Mike's right. I believe Eyes Appealin' was put on the map during the puppy stakes, and this was a dog that we weren't really talking about going in, and now it might be the best dog at the Palm Beach Kennel Club for the last year.
Right, yeah. She was kind of coming up, and all of a sudden she came into security in December, and then she just became this superstar, making every stake final possible. Yeah, that's exactly what Mike was talking about. We don't know a lot about these dogs right now, but by the end of the tournament, somebody's going to stand out, and we're going to have a star to be watching. But this thing is wide open for what's going to happen at the tournament, because a lot of these entries, a lot of people, even people that watch it every day, are not sure who these dogs are.
We do like wide open fields, though, because that's how we make money, and that is the purpose of this show here, to make you a lot of cash at the Palm Beach Kennel Club. This is the Backstretch. It's brought to you by the Palm Beach Kennel Club. This is 95.9, the True Oldies Channel. Mike Balsamo alongside Benny the Boot, Mike Jamieson, Palm Beach Jason of Watch and Wager. All right, Jason, we can start with you. Like we said, it's going to be tough to pick these winners, especially in these first couple of rounds as things start to shape up. Jason, who's an early couple of favorites for you?
Well, there is a dog I actually was talking about a couple of months ago, a dog named Oh Yeah By Far, who is actually named after the gunslinger himself, Brett Favre of the Green Bay Packers. Run for the lesser ranked kennel. He went on a pretty good run here to start. I think really about 4 or 5 wins to start his career. He went to Southland right away and just did not like it at all up there. That dog is back, and that's running for the Lester Reigns kennel. Right now, I think that's got to be your favorite, just simply because that's the kennel that we've seen and the experience. But the biggest shock to me, and I just got these entries as far as looking over, Raider Racing only has one entry. And we've talked about Raider Racing forever with how much puppy stakes experience they have, everything they've done, especially they won this tournament last year. They only have one with DS Enjoy the Ride. So, I mean, we had the Super Litter last year starting off in this tournament. This year we only have one dog, but would be surprised if that one dog from Raider didn't win this thing.
If you don't see a Raider dog in the final of a puppy stakes, something's wrong. So this is definitely a dog to keep your eyes on. Mike, you know, if Jason's talking about Favre, him being a lifelong Detroit Lions fan, to bring up a Green Bay Packer, this dog must have something to it, right, Mikey?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's great that they named the dog after the old Vikings quarterback. I really love this.
He's a Jet.
I don't know if he's officially schooled yet. Maybe he has, and maybe I'm just missing him. But, you know, when he was here, he was an absolute monster. We talked about him for weeks and weeks and weeks at a time, you know, pretty much saying he was at one point, if not the best dog at Palm Beach, one of the best at Palm Beach. You know, let's see how he comes back from Southland. I mean, it might take him a couple starts. To get, you know, better acclimated back to the Palm Beach Oval. We'll see how he does. But, you know, just like, you know, Jason mentioned, he has to be one of the favorites. And, you know, Norm Raider's not going to put, you know, he can enter 8 Greyhounds into this competition. But if he doesn't think he has, you know, a good crop of Greyhounds, he's not going to enter them in there. And, you know, that's what Raider does. I mean, he's not trying to get in here and, oh, he's not going to be satisfied with just getting one in the final. I mean, if he doesn't have Greyhounds that he knows can win this race, he's not even going to enter him, and that's why he only has one.
Jason, anybody else that you've got your eyes on here coming into the Labor Day Puppy Stakes?
Yeah, just to go on Mike's point there, he's talking about, oh, yeah, By Far schooling. He had that dog actually schooled a couple of days ago and won by 8 lengths. So I think he's liking the PBKC Oval all right. You know what? There's a couple of things you can take a look at when you're looking at puppy stakes or any other tournament. You got to look at the Douglas panel. They're always going to have somebody. And one dog I'm seeing from them is this Char Dubois, which I think that's French. We'll see. That's a good one to watch. But there's also another one from Ryan Racing, and Mike has called this the gambler, named Kenny Rogers. Like I said, running for Ryan Racing, an up-and-comer. We'll have to see how this dog does going against some better competition. But so far in the first couple races, looked okay. But the ones we talked about, those are the ones to look for sure.
Mike, what do you think? The Rambler, the Gambler, Kenny Rogers have a shot to take this down?
I love Kenny Rogers. I love this Greyhound. He's actually, you know, really already surpassed my expectations. Won a couple of big ones in a row. I believe he's in, I want to say, grade E or D right now. I think he just missed the other day. Because, you know, when a Greyhound named Kenny Rogers comes up, you know, I got to say something. So I keep looking up old song lyrics thinking, you know, everybody's going to get tired of me calling him the gambler and know when to hold him, know when to fold him. So, but, you know, I love when they name Greyhounds after people. And we have more Greyhounds named after people right now at the Kennel Club than I think we ever have in history. Because D.C. Williams has a lot of them and Brindle has a lot of them, too. I love Kenny Rogers. Is he the future superstar we're looking at? I don't know yet, but he is a good one.
You know, Jason, it's interesting that Mike brings up, you know, dogs being in C and D, and that's what we were talking about. You know, looking back on some of the other puppy stakes, we'd have, you know, races with 3 or 4 A dogs in them. Is there any A dogs at all running in this puppy stakes?
The only one I really could take a look at, the one that had the most experience, is a dog named Oh Yeah, Dream On, and that's another dog from Lester Raines and trainer Kirk Twitchick. So that's the biggest experience. Yeah, usually there is a few of these dogs that have got a bunch of experience, but with this summer stakes, I mean, it's really a lot of C and D dogs that are going after this. You know, like you said about Kenny Rogers, that's a dog that's in D right now, and that could be the puppy stakes, where last year Kyler Shirtask from Raider Racing actually won this. Everyone's talking about the Super Litter, and then it was the Kennel Mate that actually took it. So we'll have to wait and see. I'm excited to see these puppies run, though. It's always exciting no matter who's in it.
All right. This is the part of the show where we try to make you some money. Jason, what do you like for tonight? I'd love to make a little bit of cash here at PBKC.
The bet worked for me last Friday night, and I'm going to stick with it again. In the sixth race, in the sixth box, I got Bart's running loose. Again, going to go against Fraulein Audrey, our nighttime running greyhounds. Going to be running tonight or in that race. I think Bart's running loose with that experience. Going to get done again.
Guys, I want to thank you so much for popping by the Backstretch. You are listening to the Backstretch, South Florida's 95.9, the true oldies channel. Mike Balsamo alongside Benny the Boot. Benny, you know, you broke the story here last week on the Backstretch that Norm didn't really have a super litter this time. We were wondering what he had up his sleeve. Sometimes he tries to play coy, but it might be true. Norm only entered one dog in the puppy stakes.
Yeah, he's usually very honest with me, Norm, and he wasn't exactly thrilled with the puppies this year. But don't feel sorry for Norm because he's got some great dogs still running around, and they're going to win a lot of races. So Norm will be moving on, and so will all the rest of us.
Well, you know,
by the way, that was a great story that Jamieson reported about the Palm Beach Kennel Club chipping in to help the other dogs in the kennels and in the shelters around town. I think that's great. But, it's a good example of how the Palm Beach Kennel Club always pitches in locally and helps out. And people forget about that. And we talk about it all the time, right, Mike?
No, we do. The Palm Beach Kennel Club does more for local charities, whether it be people or animals, than anybody that I know. And that's why we're proud to be affiliated with PBKC. Benny, what's going on in horse racing?
Well, I'll tell you, Mike, if you like turf racing, folks, this weekend is going to be the top of your hit parade. There's three big races at Arlington Park in Chicago. It's the Million, the Beverly D, and the Secretariat. And to cap it all off in New York, they have the four-star Dave. But let's start with the two winning-you're-in races. First up is the Arlington Million. The Arlington Million is actually the signature race that is the first race ever to offer a $1 million purse, 1981. It's going to anchor Saturday's chock full of rich card on Saturday, and it includes the Beverly D for turf females. The winner of the Million and the Beverly D are going to receive berths in the Breeders' Cup Turf and the Breeders' Cup Filly and Mare Turf. In post one, it's Circus Couture at 25-1. All I can say about him, he's a very risky bet. I wouldn't do anything less than third or fourth. Number two is Spring Quality at 5-1. Reached the top of his list last time out when he won the Grade 1 Manhattan on Belmont Day. He closed from 11th to beat Sadler's Joy, and that's saying something. If there's a collapse in the Million, perhaps Spring Quality, he can contend again. But the six-year-old, I tell you, he can run from either off the pace or on the pace. He's very inconsistent. He tends not to take a lot of money. So if you like him, you're going to get another good price on him. In post three, you have Alomar, is a 15-1. This gelding won last year's Gulfstream Turf Park, and then he missed a lot of time due to an injury. He returned on June 8th in an allowance claiming race at Belmont Park. It's kind of deep waters for the second time out for him. Number four, Divisadero is 20-1. He won the Grade 3 Arlington Handicap back in July 7th. The final margin was a half a length, but the trip was rough. You know, as the Divisadero ran wide throughout, for circling the field, that doesn't necessarily mean he's going to contend in the Million tomorrow. Don't forget, he ran in this race last year and was seventh. But he's certainly eligible to hit the board, so he may be worth playing underneath. Number five is Century Dream. He's 10-1. He's going to be making his first United States start on Saturday. He's already won stake races at Ascot Epson. And he's a four-year-old shipping here that his last run on July 14th. International horses, remember this, tend to struggle less when they have quick turnarounds. He could be better suited today to compete in the Grade 1 level in America. This class could be running. You know, he's got the class coming from Acton to definitely compete with these. Number six is Cacho D.I. 30-1. He's definitely a cut below the rest. And number seven, 24-7. He's at 15-1. He looks very overmatched. Number eight is Money Multiply. He's 10-1. He won the Grade 2 Mammoth Stakes in July. And then he nearly won the United Nations. Could be a career best form, and the added distance could pay off. this guy should hit the board at a price. And then there's number nine, Duval, and he's 8-1, and he's, folks, he's Aiden O'Brien's horse. Third in the last two runnings at the Arlington Million as a favorite in 2017. This well-traveled O'Brien runner is back for another try. Curiously, his running lines for both efforts are nearly identical. He ran fourth until the stretch, took a brief lead, and then was outkicked. This is going to mark his fifth race in the form cycle, and Duval failed to fire as the favorite at Royal Ascot. I think he's primed to burn a lot more money here, folks. I don't think the third time's a charm for this one. I've got to pass. Number 10 is Robert Bruce. He's at 4-1. He was unbeaten in his first seven starts. Six of those in his native Chile, which I don't know if you put much stock in Chilean horses, but that's what it was. Before he was defeated in the Manhattan recently, considering Robert Bruce jumped bumped with rivals in the stretch, he could have been closer. He's another very formidable running at the end type of horse. Number 11, of course, is Oscar Performance, the 9-5 favorite. He jumped off the bench in June and won the Belmont Park Grade 3 Poker Stakes in track record time. Sparkling conversation that this could be the year he wins the title in the division. Winning the Million as a favorite would mark a major step in that right direction. Although already won the Grade 1 over the course, he also won back the Secretariat last year in 2017. This is his race to lose, so he could be the one to catch. Often found near the, or close to the lead. The question is the outside post going to hurt him? But this guy is a deserving favorite. If you like Oscar Performance, it's going to be tough not to like him. This race can still play a good price because of what's going on behind him. I think with Robert Bruce offering a price off a narrow defeat, Divisadero seems to be light, and Spring Quality has a target this race since he won his last time out. In addition, throw in the Century Dreamer. He's an enticing board hitter. So if you want to put Oscar Performance on top, put the rest beneath and play your trifectas. Moving on, the second one in your ridden race is the Beverly D, and that's going to feature Sister Charlie and Athena. They're going to meet for the first time in the $600,000 Beverly D. Sister Charlie opened the year with a 2.5 length victory in the Janie Wiley Stakes at Keeneland. And then it won a nose victory at the Diana Stakes at Saratoga on July 21st. Another one trained by Aiden O'Brien. Athena is the 3-1 second choice morning line and is going to carry 117. That's actually 6 pounds less than the rest of the field because she's a baby. She had 8 races in last 4 months. That doesn't happen with American horses, folks. And let's not forget about Donna Bruja, who finished second in last year's Beverly D. I'm going to box those three come Saturday. Moving on to the Secretariat, a full field of 13 are going to go to the post. The favorite, analyze it. He's just coming from Belmont Derby, and he answered the question, can he run 10 furlongs? Was it out of his reach? And it was not, folks. And given he finished well clear of Hunting Horn and Untamed Domain, second and third choices, by the way, tomorrow, he's got a real shot. Analyze has either been on the lead or in the first flight in his starts, and he should be forwardly placed again from post nine. I'm going to box analyze this, Hunting Horn and Untamed Domain. And to complete Saturday's turf at New York in Saratoga, it's the four-star day. My top pick there is going to be Voodoo Song. He's going to apply his speed from post six. Box him with Street Cry and Yoshida. And good luck today, folks, and every day. Mike, we'll see you next week.
You know, Benny, you know, you mentioned, you know, we're talking about horses. Norm and a good friend of the show, Gary Samuels, actually went to Saratoga this week, and I think they might have thrown out some bids on horses. Did you get any news on this? Are Norm and Gary buying another horse?
I haven't been informed yet, but those guys, they just like to party wherever there's action. So I don't read much into this trip to Saratoga, not to mention the fact that Saratoga is one of the richest sales venues in horse racing. So you know, Norm's kind of a middle-of-the-road guy. He's not going to buy $1 million yearling or anything like that. It's not going to happen. So we'll hear from them when they get back to how they did, and they're probably going to cry the blues that they lost their shirts.
Don't forget, Labor Day Puppy Stakes starts this week. Your Poker Room Bad Beat jackpot, $176,000. Playing poker, PBKC's the place to be. We're out of time. On behalf of Mike Jamieson, Palm Beach Jason of Watch and Wager, he's Benny the Boot. I'm Mike Balsamo. Let's talk next Friday night on The Backstretch.
This is Make Your Life Happen. We're your eyes and ears for everything lifestyle, business, and current events on what affects you. Staying connected and helping you make your life happen with ease. Now, welcome.